let's take a quick look at how a generic learning classifier system, or LCS, works. At a high level, there are three distinct components of the LCS algorithm: the environment, the learning machine, and typically a rule compaction algorithm for post-processing. The learning machine is the core of an LCS and includes several interacting components that operate in a stepwise learning cycle. The environment is the source of data upon which the LCS algorithm learns. For example, the environment could be a dataset with some number of training instances and attributes. Let's illustrate individual instances like this. Each instance has 8 attributes that can have the value 0 or 1, illustrated here by the colors orange or blue. The term endpoint refers to the variable in the data that we're trying to predict. In this example, the endpoint is one of two classes illustrated by a black or white hexagon. LCS relies on incremental learning, meaning that it learns one instance from the environment at a time. The environment interacts with the learning machine, passing it one instance, completing a learning cycle, and then returning it to the environment where it grabs the next instance. LCS iterates over the dataset repeatedly until some stop criteria are met or some maximum number of learning iterations are reached. This maximum number of learning iterations is one of the most critical LCS run parameters. Let's take a closer look inside the LCS learning machine and the steps that make up a learning cycle. The heart of the LCS is the rule population. The maximum number of rules that can be contained in the population is another critical run parameter. Ultimately, the entire population of rules collectively forms the prediction model evolved by the LCS. This is a characteristic of Michigan-style learning classifier systems. Let's take a closer look at rules. An LCS rule is not in itself a model. Rather, it is only part of a model. A rule can be broken down into two parts, classically described as the condition and the action, which form a simple if-then expression. The condition of a rule specifies values for some attributes in the dataset. Let's visualize the condition of the rule like this. As with training instances, specified attributes are illustrated as half circles with colors representing their respective attribute values. Attributes that are not specified in the rule are represented as empty half circles with a hashtag below them. Traditionally, attributes that are not specified in a rule are represented with a hashtag and considered to be wildcards. These can match any attribute value. Wildcards allow rules to generalize, capturing useful relationships without completely overfitting rules to the training data. The action part of the rule gives the predicted endpoint. We'll use black or white hexagons to represent the predicted class for the rule. The term rule is used to refer to this combination of condition and action, but the term classifier is typically applied to refer to the rule along with its associated parameters. Let's talk about a few common ones. Numerosity is the number of classifier copies that symbolically exist in the population. The match count is the number of times the rule has been in a match set. The correct count is the number of times it's been in a correct set. The accuracy of the rule is calculated by dividing the correct count by the match count. Note that rule accuracy is different than the training accuracy of a machine learning model. Rule fitness is typically a function of accuracy calculated to reflect the quality or utility of a classifier. Fitness is a critical parameter, as it probabilistically influences the survival, reproductive success, and the predictive influence of a rule within the population as a whole. Now let's walk through the steps of a learning cycle. The first step is getting a training instance from the environment. The next step is finding all rules in the population that have a condition matching the attribute values of the instance. To explain the process of matching, let's first assume that we already have many rules in our population. Matching compares the current training instance to all rules in the population. For example, matching looks at each attribute specified in the rule and checks whether it matches the value in the instance. Any wildcards in the rule match by default. The endpoint value is ignored in matching. If all specified attributes match, the rule is moved to the match set. Let's see a few other examples of matching. Next, the match set is divided into a correct set and an incorrect set. Rules that have a class prediction that matches the true class of the training instance form the correct set, and those that don't form the incorrect set. At this point, if no rules made it into the correct set, then the covering mechanism is applied. Covering is one of the two mechanisms that can introduce new rules into the population, also known as rule discovery. Covering ensures that LCS explores rules that cover all parts of the data space, while preventing LCS from wasting time exploring rules that wouldn't match anything in the data. Different from most other evolutionary algorithms, LCS rule populations typically start off empty. Because of this, covering serves as a form of smart population initialization. Covering works by generating a rule condition which randomly specifies a subset of attribute values in the current training instance, and applies wildcards to the rest. The action, or predicted class for the rule, is set to the class of the current training instance. Now let's assume that we have a correct set with at least one rule in it and an incorrect set that may have some rules as well. The next step is to update the parameters of classifiers that have made it into either the correct or incorrect sets. Classifiers in the correct set see an increase in both match and correct count, thus increasing accuracy as well as fitness. Classifiers in the incorrect set will see an increase in the match count, but not the correct count, decreasing accuracy and fitness. Depending on the LCS algorithm, a number of other updates can take place at this step. Unlike most machine learners, LCS modeling has an implicit generalization pressure. In particular, rules that specify fewer attributes are likely to appear in match sets more frequently, and in turn, likely to be chosen as parents more frequently by the genetic algorithm in the next step. This yields an implicit evolutionary pressure, encouraging more general rules. Beyond this, an explicit generalization mechanism referred to as subsumption is often applied to LCS. Put simply, the subsumption mechanism examines pairs of rules and looks for a situation in which one of the rules is a subsumer. A subsumer rule must cover all of the problem space of the other rule, and must be more general as well as just as accurate. The subsumer subsumes the more specific rule, meaning that the subsumer is effectively copied by increasing its numerosity, while the more specific rule is eliminated from the population. Subsumption can be applied to the rules of the correct set after updating parameters, as well as to the parent and offspring rules following the genetic algorithm, or GA, step. Some studies suggest that only using GA subsumption is a more conservative option with less risk of degrading learning performance. The next step applies a simple genetic algorithm as the second of the two rule discovery mechanisms. While other heuristics could be used to discover rules, the GA is most commonly used. The LCS genetic algorithm is highly elitist, meaning that each learning iteration, the vast majority of classifiers are preserved in the population. In fact, only two new offspring rules are typically generated by the GA and added to the rule population each learning cycle. The LCS genetic algorithm typically includes three mechanisms: selection, crossover, and mutation. Selection picks two parent rules from the correct set as templates for offspring rules. Selection mechanisms such as roulette wheel or deterministic selection could be used, but tournament selection is currently the preferred approach. Tournament selection randomly selects a portion of classifiers from the correct set, and then deterministically takes the classifier with the highest fitness from this subset to be a parent. New offspring rules emerge from the parent rule templates by applying mutation and crossover, the two most common genetic operators. These operators are typically designed to generate offspring rules that still match the current training instance and retain the correct prediction. Crossover is applied first, according to a user-defined likelihood. While there are various crossover strategies, uniform crossover is particularly well-suited to generating diversity. Both crossover and mutation modify offspring rules by either changing a specified attribute into a wildcard, or turning a wildcard into a specified attribute that has the value seen in the current training instance. Crossover looks for attributes that are specified in one parent but not the other, and for each, flips a coin and decides whether to swap specification and generalization. Following crossover, each offspring rule has the potential to be modified further by the mutation operator. Each attribute in the rule has some random chance of swapping from specified to generalized, or vice versa, thus adding new variation to the offspring rules. Before adding the offspring rules to the population, their rule parameters are initialized to make them classifiers, and GA subsumption can be applied. At this point, any classifiers that have been involved in the learning cycle are returned to the rule population. The last step is to enforce the limited size of the rule population using deletion. The maximum population size is the sum of all rule numerosities in the population. If the number of classifiers in the population is larger than this maximum, classifiers are deleted in turn until that size limit is met. Classifiers are selected from the whole population for deletion, with a probability inversely proportional to their fitness. Other factors can be applied to increase the probability of deletion, such as the classifier's numerosity. This keeps the population from being overrun by just a few rules with large numerosities. Stepping back, we can see this learning cycle in action. Each iteration, new rules are discovered. Some rules gain experience by matching the new training instance, and evolutionary pressures in the system encourage the fittest rules to reproduce while eliminating the least fit. Once the last learning iteration is reached, the resulting rule population can be applied as a model. However, there's often a post-processing step applied to the rule population after training. This is known as rule compaction, or in some cases, condensation. A number of rule compaction strategies have been proposed, but they all typically seek to remove poor, redundant, or inexperienced rules from the population. Ultimately, rule compaction simplifies the rule population model, improves interpretability, and even can improve predictive performance. We've seen how LCS learns, but how can we apply the resulting classifier set as a prediction model? Let's assume we want to evaluate the prediction accuracy of the rule population as a model on some testing data that the algorithm has not seen during training. When being applied as a prediction machine, all learning components in the system are deactivated. An instance is passed from the testing data to the LCS, where all classifiers in the population that match it form a match set. Differently, the match set is now passed to a prediction array, which is responsible for making a class prediction based on the votes of these matching classifiers. The vote of each classifier is typically proportional to its fitness and numerosity. One of the simplest voting schemes is to sum the votes of all rules proposing the same class and choose the class with the highest overall vote. A number of alternative prediction schemes have also been proposed. The testing accuracy of LCS as a prediction machine is the proportion of correct predictions that were made by the prediction array over the entire testing dataset. The prediction array could also be applied during LCS learning to estimate training accuracy of the rule population as it evolves. Keep in mind that many LCS algorithms have been proposed with variations to improve performance and accommodate application to a variety of problem domains. This video has used a Michigan-style learning classifier system designed for supervised learning as an accessible example, but Pittsburgh-style systems and hybrid systems have also been proposed, as well as a wealth of research applying LCS algorithms to reinforcement learning problems such as behavior modeling. Thanks for listening to Learning Classifier Systems in a Nutshell. I'm Dr. Ryan Urbanowitz. Funding for the production of this video came from the Computational Genetics Lab of Dr. Jason H. Moore at the University of Pennsylvania's Institute for Biomedical Informatics.